So, okay, now, so Ish-bosheth is Saul's son, but what we need to know is Ish-bosheth, who is Saul's general? Saul, King Saul, had a general. His name was Abner. David had a general, and his general's name was Joab. Okay, so those are the two guys. Saul had his main general was Abner. David's main general was Joab. Now, when Joab appears in the narrative, what's Joab going to do? Almost every time he does exactly the same thing. Joab does what to people? Yeah, Joab kills them, okay? Joab is a killer, okay? Joab is David's general, and almost every time he appears in the narrative, he's killing somebody, okay? Abner is Saul's general, and he's going to do some things there too. Joab, then, is going to kill Abner. And let me just tell you the story of how this happens, and then I want to look at David's compassion in the story. Joab and Abner were the two generals of Saul and David, respectively. They got together at a pool called the Pool of Gibeon. Do you remember the Gibeonites, okay, the ones that made an alliance with Israel? There's a pool in Gibeon about from that pillar to this pillar to around where I am. It's a huge pool. There's a pool. And Joab's men and Abner's men sat around the pool, and Joab and Abner, the two generals, say, hey, why don't you let these young guys get up and grapple and fight each other? See whose guys are tougher, you know, that kind of thing. So the guys get up and they start getting into, you know, battle and stuff, and then it gets thicker and thicker, and all of a sudden people start killing each other. So Abner says, I'm getting out of here. This is getting dangerous. You know, these guys are killing stuff. So Abner takes off running. Now, Abner's the big, strong general. Joab's younger brother is a guy named Asahel, and it says he was fleet of foot, which meant he was quick. And so Asahel chases after Abner, and Abner turns around to Asahel and he says, Asahel, get off my tail, man. I don't want to hurt you, because if I hurt you, I got to answer to whom? Your older brother. Do older brothers take care of younger brothers? And so what happens is, actually, I got a great story of that when I was young. This happened 40 years later. My brother remembered this. When I was young, my brother came home from school one day and some kids had jumped up and beat him up, okay? He got home. I'm the older brother. What did I do? I whip off my belt, put it around my fist, and I went out and took care of business, okay? And so when I got home, it was just over, you know what I'm saying? It's over. It's cool. We're done. They won't be bothering you again. It's okay and stuff. I get home. Did you know, 40 years later, when one of my kids was getting married, my brother was telling nasty stories about me. And what he says is, one of the things I remember about my brother was that whenever I got in trouble like that, he'd go out and took my side. He protected me, and he took care of business and stuff. And he remembered that 40 years later. I had forgotten totally about it. But anyways, what I'm saying is, the older brother. So what happens? Abner says to Asahel, get off my tail. I don't want to fight Joab, so just back off. And he takes the butt end of his spear, and he pushes the kid back with the butt end of his spear. But what's the problem? The butt end of the spear goes through the kid, and he ends up killing the kid by accident. And then it's like, oh, no, Joab's going to be on his case. So now what happens? Abner's over here with Ish-bosheth, and Ish-bosheth has got Saul's concubine, who's named Ritzpah. I never could understand that. It's like the floor lady. Ritzpah means floor. But anyway, so Abner says, can I have Ritzpah, the concubine of Saul? And Ish-bosheth freaks out. And Abner says, hey, man, I fought for Saul like for 20 years and stuff, and now you won't. Nothing. He says, I'm going over to David. So basically, Abner takes himself and his troops. He goes over to David. And he says to David, I want to make an alliance with you. I'll bring the kingdom over to you, David. You'll have territories on both sides of the Jordan River now. And basically, Abner and David make an alliance. Joab's not there. Joab shows up and he says, hey, David, you should never have made an alliance with Abner. Abner tried to kill you, man. What'd you do that for? So Joab sends and says, Abner, come back here. Abner comes back thinking he's going to talk with Joab. Joab takes out his knife, sticks him in the fifth rib, kills Abner in cold blood. So now Abner is dead and he's been killed in cold blood. And what's David's response to this? Joab stabbed him. And it says down in verse 32, this is chapter 3, verse 32, it says, they buried Abner in Hebron, and the king wept aloud at Abner's tomb. And all the people wept also. Abner was killed in cold blood by Joab. That was murder. Joab killed him. The king sang a lament for Abner. And then the people came and urged David to eat something. Why did the men come and David was what? He wasn't eating. okay? When something's really tragic, you don't eat, right? And so David's fasting and just not eating because he's so upset with this while it was still day. But David took an oath saying, may God deal with me, be it ever so severely, if I taste bread or anything else before the sun sets. All the people took note and were pleased. Indeed, everything the king did pleased them. So on that day, all the people and all Israel knew that the king had no part in it. Okay? So David wept for Abner, and he said basically wouldn't eat until, you know, the sun was down and stuff. And David and all the people knew that David had nothing to do with the murder of Abner, and that it was Joab's fault. Okay? So David's compassionate, and even with his enemy here, he shows respect to Abner, even though Abner had tried to kill him. So David's response and the people's response is the people know David had compassion on Abner, his enemy, and weeps for them. And this is kind of how the story goes down. That's a second situation where David shows compassion. Here's another one. This is over in chapter 9, 2 Samuel chapter 9. This is a beautiful story. Not totally beautiful, but it's Mephibosheth. Say that fast three times. Mephibosheth, okay? Mephibosheth. David now is king over everything. He's got Israel, he's got Jordan, the area. David's the king over everything. Okay? David says, are there any of Saul's descendants? Are there any of Saul's descendants that I can help? David's in position of power. Now he says, are there any left over of Saul's descendants that I can help? And they say, yeah, there's one guy named Mephibosheth, but what's Mephibosheth's problem? He's lame in both legs. Apparently, when the nurse was carrying him, either she had dropped him or fell on him or something, and the guy's crippled in both legs. Now, by the way, in our culture, if you're crippled in both legs, is it really a big problem? You can get prosthetics, you can get, you know, elevators taking you up, you get a wheelchair, you can even race in the wheelchair and things. Anyways, in our culture, it's a problem, but not a real. In that problem, when you don't have it, question, did they have wheelchairs? Did they have, you know, escalators? Did they have elevators and things like that? No. And so this guy, David, looks at this guy and says, oh, Mephibosheth is whose son, by the way? Jonathan's son. And remember, David made a vow with Jonathan that he would take care of his descendants forever? So David basically takes care of Mephibosheth, and this is a beautiful situation. He says, Mephibosheth, you can eat at my table from now and forever. You are considered like one of the king's sons. I will feed you forever. And that was the first welfare program that was ever in existence. David taking care of Mephibosheth. Okay? That's kind of the storyline behind it, and this is the point that I want to draw from it. Okay, the goodness of a person can be seen, can be measured on how they treat people who cannot pay them back anything. Okay, you want to get a promotion and you're working down at a corporation down in Boston like my son was. A guy comes in, he works 4 hours a day. You come in and you work 8-9 hours a day. The guy works 4 hours a day. Even in those 4 hours, he barely does any work. But question, what does the four-hour-a-day guy do? He goes out golfing with the boss every day. Or, whenever the boss goes out on weekends and stuff. He goes what with the boss? He goes golfing all the time with the boss. Kind comes for raises. Who's going to get the raise? The one that goes out golfing with the boss or the one that does the work? The one that does the work should get the raise. No. The one who is working 4 hours a day, coming in at 10 and going home at 2, going out golfing with the boss, he gets the raise, okay? Is that how it works? You do favors, you become friendly with somebody, and then all of a sudden you get the promotions up and things like that. Now, is that fair? Is that right? No, it's not, but that's how it works oftentimes. Do people work people that are over them? Do people work people that are over them to try to garner favors from them? Okay? That's how it normally works. So you want to go against that. You say, what did Mephibosheth have that David needed? Nothing. And so this, in other words, David is not getting anything out of this. David is just, this is grace. This is grace. This is compassion. David has compassion and grace on Mephibosheth and provides for him. And it's wonderful what David did. He's not wanting anything from Mephibosheth. So how do you treat people that are outcasts? How do you treat people that don't fit in? How do you treat people that don't fit in? That's a mark of your character. And everybody always wants, you know, the people that are on the top, but how do they treat the people on the bottom? David, compassionate guy, he goes after Mephibosheth, invites him into his home, and takes care of him for the rest of his life. Mephibosheth had his problems. Some of the other later things we're going to skip, but